195. Let's turn over to In My Heart There Rings a Melody. Let's all stand together as we sing. I have a song that Jesus gave me. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to sing. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory, when the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony, when the chorus of heaven ring. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love.
All right, good singing this morning. Good to see you in church today. A beautiful morning to come to the house of God. Thanks for making the effort to be here. Had a wonderful, wonderful time last night at a bonfire and hayride out at the Manning place, and just a wonderful time of fellowship together, and just a good time. And then a World Series win by the Indians, and we're ready to go, man. And looking forward to a great morning this morning, what the Lord will have to do for us. And let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for another opportunity for us to gather together here. And Lord, we bow here at the beginning of the service and ask for you to meet with us today. We want the service to be exactly what you desire it to be. We ask you to use the music, use the fellowship, honor the preaching of your word. Use those things in our lives to accomplish your will in each one of our hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that each of us would say, not my will, but thine be done in my heart and life today. So control the service. And Lord, I'll thank you now in advance what I believe you'll do here in our midst this morning. And if any's come in today and they've never come to know Christ as their personal Savior, I pray they would trust him as their Savior today. May he be lifted up in our service. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed your light afar. To the many duties ever new, you now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across a bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Just above our clouded sky that you may help to clear. Let not narrow self your weighty bar. Though into one heart alone may fall your song of cheer. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across a bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Here for all your talents you may surely find a need. Here reflect the bright and morning star. Even from your humble hand the bread of life may feed. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across a bar. Brighten the corner where you are. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Hey, that song they sang, Bright in the Corner Where You Are, did you? I hope you caught the words to that. How many of you know that song or you're kind of familiar with it? Not very many. And this was written by a girl who really had a future in entertainment. Back in those days, it was the theater, and she could sing, she could act, and she had a father that fell ill. And it was, do I stay home and take care of my father, or do I pursue my career? And as she talked to somebody, someone encouraged her, you know what, just brighten the corner where you are. And she stayed home and took care of her dad and wrote that song that we're still singing now, probably over 100-some years later. And the people that have been blessed and encouraged. That's why it said, don't wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Don't wait to shed your light afar. That's what she was hoping to do. To the many duties ever near you, now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. You understand what she was going through and what choice she was making at that time. And then she said, just above are clouded skies that you may help to clear. Trying to understand, what should I do? Let not narrow self your way debar. Don't let self get in the way and mess you up. Though into one heart alone may fall your song of cheer. Whose one heart would that be? Her dad. He's taking care of him. I'll cheer him up. Amen. Brighten the corner where you are. I won't be cheering the hearts of thousands, singing to them, but I can cheer his heart. I'll brighten the corner where I am. Here, for all your talent, you may surely find a need. Here, reflect the bright and morning star. Even from your humble hand, the bread of life may feed. Brighten the corner where you are. What a great, great song. And a great story behind the song. Of the choice she made. Let's sing it one more time. Have these guys come and sing it one more time, okay? You can add the little light on the end if you want, but I want you to hear this one, okay? All right, do it one more time, okay?
Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed your light afar. To the many duties ever near you, now be true. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across a bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Just above a clouded sky that you may help you clear. Let a narrow self your way debar. Though into one heart alone may fall your song of cheer. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across a bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Here for all your talent you may surely find a need. Here reflect the bright and morning star. Even from your humble hand the bread of life may be. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Brighten the corner where you are. Someone far from harbor you may guide across the bar. Brighten the corner where you are. Little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Amen. Very good. All right, well, would you turn with me to number 311, 311, redeemed. How I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Let's sing that first. You may remain seated. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. I'm redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Let's sing that last together. I know I shall see in His beauty the King and His law I delight, who lovingly guarded my footsteps and given me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
All right. Now a few announcements for us. By the way, the schedule today, 5:45 tonight. Just bring those on up, Bill. 5:45 tonight for our organizational meeting for the Turkey Dinner Sunday. 2 weeks from today is Turkey Dinner Sunday. That's amazing, isn't it? And the flyers are there. They're in the conference room. They're turned every 50. So sign them out. Pass them out. All right. Invite folks to come. The reservation cards are there. You invite somebody to come. Be your guest. We're going to have some special incentives that you're going to be able to obtain if you have the most guests here on the 13th of November. So you want to get them to fill the card out, bring this card back in with you. We'll contact them again Saturday right before the dinner day and assure that they're coming. If they need a ride, we'll get them a ride. We'll make sure that they get here to the service that day. So that's November 13th, and we'll organize that tonight, and the turkeys and the food and all the things we have to get together for that day, 5:45 sharp tonight, okay? And then 6:30 will be the evening service, and we'll have a great time together here this evening as we prepare for Operation Saturation, okay? That means every day. Church is open, flyers will be out, come in, sign them out, and just plan to do something every day, getting them out. 15,000 of them to get out in about 12 days or so, so we got to keep a good pace up, okay? And so be a part of that, inviting folks to come and invite people to be your guests. Put it on your social media, spread the word, and let's have a great, great crowd here on November 13th, okay? The calling hours for Brother Fred's sister, Angel, is down at the Jerry Spears Funeral Home. That's this afternoon from 2 to 5 p.m., all right? So I remember that, and you can see the messers there, okay? And I'm looking, and I think that's all I have right now. Remember, next Saturday night, you fall back an hour. You get an extra hour sleep next Saturday night. How good is that? And that's wonderful. I was telling folks in Sunday school, I sure could have used it last night, but it works out all right. I guess we'll take it whenever we get it, all right? But don't forget to fall back next Saturday night, okay? All right, let's take a moment now. Let's welcome any guests we have with us in the service. We're always pleased when folks visit with us in our service. And if you're visiting here this morning, we'd love to meet you, find out who you are and where you're from. If it's your first time here or if you brought a guest with you, would you honor us by standing just for a moment? We could find out who you are and where you're from. All right, anybody here today, first time? I know we got some folks back here. Go ahead, stand. Don't be bashful, Amanda. Your girls, okay? Go ahead, Amanda, you start us, okay? Great. All right. Fantastic. Okay. Great. It's good to have you folks. Recently moved here, and it's great to have been in church today. God bless you, Amanda. Thanks for making it. And Xavier, is that right? Wow, I didn't. There's another Xavier in the world. How about that? We got another one up here. Wow, that's wonderful. Thank you for being here. You may be seated. That's great. Right here. Yes, sir. Yeah. Amen. Had a layover and come to church. Praise the Lord, man. That says a lot about you folks. Praise God. That's great. Thank you for being here this morning. All right. If you'll take just a moment and fill out the welcome card, we appreciate you doing that. We'd like to have a record of your visit with us this morning. In a little bit, when the offering goes by, just put that card in the plate if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming this morning. We're glad you're here. Let's give them a warm welcome, shall we?
In your hymnal 335, there shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. 335, would you sing that first with me, please? There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing, sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. On that third, there shall be showers of blessing. Send them upon us, O Lord. Grant to us now a refreshing. Come and now honor thy word. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. Amen. Children, you can be dismissed to junior church as we sing this last stanza together. Children, you're dismissed to junior church on that last. There shall be showers of blessing. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing. Now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. Amen. Well, let's go over to 538. Blessed be the name of the Lord. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme. Would you stand with me as we sing? 538 on that first together. All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Redeemer, Savior, friend of men, once ruined by the fall, thou hast devised salvation. one plan, for thou hast died for all. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's sing that last all together. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace. Of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, his reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name,
seated. Ushers will come and be ready to receive our offering now this morning. If you have filled out your welcome card, please put that in the plate when it goes by. And the rest of us, let's give as God has blessed us and prospered us, okay? They're dead. Well, I'll pray for the offering this morning, all right? Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for the privilege to give back to you a portion of that which you've given to us. And I thank you for the faithful giving of the people of Bible Baptist Church. And Lord, I pray that our giving would reflect our love for you. And I pray you'll take the offerings today and it'll meet the needs of your work in this place. And may it be for the furtherance of the gospel of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Take your Bibles this morning, if you would, please, to John chapter 20. John chapter 20, please, for our scripture reading. The Gospel of John chapter 20. We're going to read verses 11 through 17 this morning. Verses 11 through 17. We've heard these verses responsively. We begin together on verse 11, then I'll read 12, then together on 13, and alternating like that till we end together on verse 17 of John chapter 20. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 11. Ready? But Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, Woman, Why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said unto him, Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. And Jesus saith unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. And Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Now, Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this morning. We thank you, Lord, for giving us your word, that we hold copies of the word of God in our hand this morning. And I pray, Lord, that each of us would be asking you to make our hearts ready to hear the truth that you have for us today. Lord, I pray that you would minister to each and every heart as only you can. I ask your blessing on the special now as it's sung, that it will prepare us and make us ready to hear what the Spirit would say to his church this morning. It's in Christ's name that we ask it. Amen.
Lost in my sin, no hope within, bound by the deeds I had done. Then the Lord took hold of my sinful soul. Now I'm saved through God's Son. Since Jesus came, I've been set free. My sins are canceled eternally. Jesus is worthy of highest praise. My life is different since Jesus came. Now through each day I watch and pray, looking for Jesus to come. For someday I know, up to heaven I'll go, when this life's race is run. Since Jesus came, I've been set free. My sins are canceled eternally. Jesus is worthy of highest praise. My life is different since Jesus came. Call on his name, he'll set you free. Your life will be different eternally. Jesus is worthy of highest praise. Your life will be different when you call on his name. Yes, my life is different since I called on his name.
Amen. Father, we thank you now for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the truth of that song and the difference you have made in our lives since we called on your name. And Lord, I pray this morning that if any in the room has never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus and ask him to be their Savior, that this morning they would call upon him, who is not just a Savior, but he's the Savior. And I pray that they would understand what it is to have their sins forgiven, their names written down in heaven, and be recipients of the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Father, I pray now that you'll help each of us to focus and concentrate upon the message that you have for us today. Again, I want to thank you for your word, and I pray, Holy Spirit, now you'll do your work in each and every heart. Help me as I bring this message and help each individual as they listen. May we grasp the truth that you have for us today. It's in Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. The first person to the tomb on the resurrection day was Mary Magdalene. Of course, some of the other women were along with her. Now, they left to run tell the disciples that Jesus was risen from the dead. We'll let these folks get seated. Okay. And the disciples, as you remember, come to the tomb to see for themselves, and they see indeed that the tomb is empty, and then they return to the upper room. But Mary seems to have tarried there, weeping, outside the garden tomb. The angels speak to her and ask her who she's seeking and what is happening, and then a man who she thinks is the gardener does not recognize him as Jesus, speaks to her, and then she doesn't recognize him until Jesus says her name. If you notice with me in John 20, in verse number 16, Jesus saith unto her, Mary. And boy, by the way, aren't you glad he knows your name? You're not a number, you're a name, amen? And he says the name, and then she turned herself and said unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master, Master. I want to focus on that word, the last word of that verse this morning, the word Master. I'm recalling when Mary and Martha, a different Mary, but with Mary and Martha, whose brother Lazarus had died. And remember, Jesus comes and he's been dead 4 days now. Martha runs out to meet him and she talks to Jesus. And then she sends word back to Mary. She said, you need to get out here. The Master's calling for you. She called him Master. And all through the New Testament, you'll find, I recorded 18 different times, 18 different occasions that people called Jesus Master. Master. We don't like that too well. Because if Jesus is Master, what does that make us? Yeah, not just servants, slaves. And there's a difference, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. But, you know, I read this story, and I don't know if it's actually true or not, but it's said of Abraham Lincoln that he went to the slave block to buy back a slave girl. As she looked at the white man bidding on her, she figured another white man going to buy her and abuse her. But he won the bid, and as he's walking away with his property, he said, young lady, you are free. She said, what does that mean? I said, it means you're free. She said, does that mean I can say whatever I want to say? He said, you can say whatever you want to say. She said, does that mean I can be whatever I want to be? He said, you can be whatever you want to be. Does that mean I can go wherever I want to go? He said, that means you can go wherever you want to go. And tears began to come down her face. And she said, then I choose to go with you. That I choose to go with you. I don't know if that's true or not, but if it is true, it does illustrate what the relationship ought to be between us and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Because he purchased us. The Bible says we are not our own. We've been bought with a price. And the price that we've been bought with is the blood of Jesus Christ. We've not been redeemed or purchased or bought back with silver and gold or the things of man. The Bible says we've been bought back with the precious blood of Christ. And now we're willingly say, I want to be your slave. I want to stay with you. I choose to stay with you. As Christians, oftentimes, especially in this contemporary Christian society, the focus is not on the master, the focus is on the slave. Think about this. You hear about freedom, you hear about liberation, you hear about health, wealth, prosperity. We hear how God wants everybody healthy, wealthy, and prosperous. Find your own fulfillment, fulfill your own dream, find your own purpose. It's all focused on the slave and not focused on the master. It's completely turned upside down. But the truth is, it's just exactly contradictory to what the Bible teaches. The Bible, listen, it is not about the slave. It's all about the master. It's not about us. It is about him. And we've turned that thing around and we want it to be all about us. That God's in it for us, and God thinks about you, and God does think about us, and God does love us unconditionally. But listen, my friend, there's some responsibility on our part. Sometimes when we witness to people, and it's not wrong to say trust Christ or surrender to Jesus or turn to Jesus, and that's what you have to do to be saved. But I think sometimes people don't understand that when you come to Christ, you will belong to Christ. You, that He paid for your sin when He died on the cross, and that now you belong to Him. We ought to be able to say, I have no will but your will. I have no desires but your desires. I have no plans but your plans. There's a difference between a slave and a servant. Servants are hired to work for wages. And servants can quit if they want to. They have that option. Slaves do not. When Hebrew slaves made the decision to remain with their master, it was a lifetime commitment. They would, most slaves, every seventh year, you could be set free. That's why even if a man had a debt, he could go to work for somebody. He could go be a slave to somebody. He'd have to work 6 years. But in the seventh year, that was a year he could be set free. And by the way, debt's wiped out. I mean, you'd like it if debts would be wiped out every 6 years. And I know, that'd be kind of cool, wouldn't it? And but if he didn't want to leave his master, and he wanted to voluntarily stay, then he would stay, and he'd go near a doorpost, and they would put his ear to that doorpost, and they'd bore it through with an awl. And that was just a mark of it to everybody else that they're a slave, but they are a willing slave. They have committed their life. And by the way, that's not just for a year. That's not for 2 years. That's for the rest of their life. They will be a slave to their master. We want to enjoy all the benefits, but we don't like much the responsibilities that go with the benefits. I want my master to do this for me and this for me and this for me, and if he doesn't, then I'm going to complain about what a hard master he is. Because the focus isn't on the master, the focus seems to be on me. The slave doesn't choose when it's convenient for him to serve. The slave doesn't reserve the right to refuse a task that was handed to him from his master. A slave could not go off and do what he wants for a while and then come back. That's why the whole book of Philemon's in the New Testament, Paul writing on behalf of a runaway slave, Onesimus, to Philemon, who he ran away from, urging him not to take his life, which he would have a right to do. The slave's life was consistent service to his master. That was his life. To a slave, serving his master wasn't a slice of his life. It was his life. This is what he was about. It's who he was. Jesus said in John 14:15, you know the verse, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. As slaves to Jesus Christ, he's the master, we are required to serve him. Too many people want the benefits of the relationship without serving him. Deliver me from my sins. Rescue me from hell. Give me eternal life. Build me a mansion in heaven. But surrender to you? Wait a minute, God. You want me to do what? We want all the benefits, and we don't want to serve him. No, Lord, I want all that. I want eternal life. I want a home in heaven. I want my sins forgiven, but I still want to go where I want to go. I still want to do what I want to do. I want to serve you, but Lord, not if it's going to inconvenience me. That's not the life of a slave. That's the life of a spoiled brat. Sorry about that. Let me give you three simple thoughts this morning about the word master, as Mary uses it here in John chapter 20. Number one is this: master meant that he was everything. Master meant that he was everything. Master is an all-inclusive word. It means ruler, it means lord, it means commander, it means boss. And so when Mary says, Rabboni, your master, she's saying, you're my lord, you're my leader, you're my commander, you're my boss, you're everything to me. I'll do as you say. I'll follow your commands. I'll sit at your feet. Can I tell you this morning that everything you need is found in Jesus Christ? We sing the song here, Jesus Christ is made to me all I need, all I need. But we is that something we sing, or is it something we really believe? When we have a struggle, when we have problems, where do we go? See, do we go to Christ and say, you have what I need? When the marriage is in trouble, or the relationship's bad, or the child's gone away from home, do we go to Christ to say, you have what I need? When the addiction grabs a hold of us and we can't beat it and it's got its chains wrapped around us, do we go to Jesus Christ and say, you're the one that can help me? I believe Christ can meet every need of your heart and life. I believe that. I don't think he has the answer. I think he is the answer. I believe the man who sat at the bar last night drinking his sorrows, or drinking his worries, or drinking his troubles until 2 o'clock in the morning, or 3 o'clock whenever the bars closed down, I think what that guy's looking for is Jesus Christ. I believe the person who's working 80 or 90 or 100 hours a week, I think what they're looking for is Jesus Christ. The man who's trying to stack up his money and save his money and get all he can. Somebody told me this week there was a family that, I think it was Andy, said something about that somebody from the hospital who told him there's a family of four that got four tickets for the World Series game in Chicago right behind home plate. $25,000 per seat. $100,000 to see the Cubs lose. How sad. How sad if this is what your life has been about, and say, boy, this is what I've been waiting for all my life. Oh, I've been waiting all my life for this. Well, how disappointed are you going to be? What you're looking for, that emptiness you're trying to fill, my friend, with a sports team, is found in Jesus Christ. I thought it was interesting when they talked to Urban Meyer after last week's game when they lost to Penn State. He said, you know what? The sun came up Sunday morning. Realize, you know what he said? There's more to life than a football game. And by the way, there is more to life than a football game, more to life than a sporting event. I believe that what every person's seeking in pleasure, what they're looking for is Jesus Christ. What the addict needs is Jesus Christ. I've got what they're, hey, we have what they're looking for. We have what they're searching for. They're trying everything they know to try to fill the hole in their heart. And the only thing that's going to fill that hole in their heart is Jesus Christ. He's everything. All you need is found in Him. You may have come in today to the service, and listen, your heart may be empty. You may not understand what, I'm not even sure why I came to church. I'm not sure why I'm in here. I'm not sure I believe the Bible. I'm not sure I believe in heaven. And by the way, don't you wish you could? And I got news for you this morning. You can. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. My master meant He's everything. He's everything. Let me give you statement number two. Notice what she said. She said, Master, and literally it is my master. Did you know there's a difference between a teacher and my teacher? Did you know there's a difference in the church when people say that's the pastor of the church, and when people look at the pastor and say, that's my pastor? There's a difference. There's a difference in that. There's a difference between you look at Jesus Christ and say, that's the Savior, and when you say, that's my Savior. There's a difference. And Mary is saying, my master. My master. She was once possessed with seven devils. Did you know that's who God can use? God uses people who the world has already used up and chewed up and spit out, and God will pick you up and say, let me clean you up. I think I can still use you. God, you say, well, I've got problems, Pastor. Well, guess what? So does everybody else. Well, I got issues. Guess what? So does everybody else. God only has crooked sticks to use, my friend. We're all crooked sticks. But thank God He uses crooked sticks. I'm thankful for that. Some of you remember, you may drive by a bar or drive by a tavern and say to yourself, man, I remember the days when I'd spend hours in that place. And you can't believe, sometimes you shake your head and you say, man, I just can't believe I used to do that. I'm not that same person anymore. Hallelujah. You're kind of like the blind man in John chapter 9. After Jesus heals the blind man in John chapter 9, people see him. Now this is a fellow, in fact, look there. You're only in John 20. Just go back a few chapters with me, will you? Look in John chapter 9. This is a great chapter. The Bible says, Jesus passed by, He saw a man which was blind from his birth. And disciples asked Him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he's born blind? And Jesus answered, neither hath this man sinned, nor his parents. But that the works of God might be made manifest in him. I must work the works of Him that sent me while it's day. The night cometh when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When He had thus spoken, He spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle. He anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And He said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went His way therefore and washed and came seeing. Now here it is. The neighbors, therefore, and they which before had seen him that was blind, said, is not this he that sat and begged? And some said, this is he. Others said, he's like him. But he said, I am he. See, some of them looked at him and said, no, that's not him. It just looks like him. That can't be him. And some of you, listen, some of you have been saved and you're now God has done such a radical work in your life, you're not a shadow of what you once were. And if you run into people who knew you then, they'd look at you now and say, man, you look like a guy I used to know. Huh? You say, well, I'm that guy, but I'm not that guy anymore. I'm a different person now. Just like Brother Xavier said about that fellow that you met in the work that says, hey, that guy's going to be surprised. I'm not drinking anymore. And boy, that get everybody looking up. What happened to you? You're not drinking anymore. He said, I got saved 86 days ago. I haven't had a drink in 86 days. Praise God. He's a different person. You know what happened? When you get saved, a change takes place. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. You're a new creation, man. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And changes begin to take place. He got saved. That's the blind guy. He's not blind anymore. Now he sees. And he looks different than he did. And he talks different than he did. And he walks different than he did. He's a different man. He's a new creature in Christ. He changes you. The maniac in Mark 5, we've been studying him on Friday evenings in Reformers Unanimous, and what a change in that man's life. From a maniac to a missionary, going out and telling others what great things Jesus had done for him. God can take a blasphemer and a persecutor and a murderer and change him into a preacher and a church planner and a Bible translator. From Saul to Paul. You know what? Jesus can do that for you. My master can do that for you. Say, I don't know if I'd ever be like her or be like him. Oh, no, no. You're not trying to be like some other Christian. But Jesus can change your life. He'll make changes in you that you will never believe. Sometimes I run into people and they say, well, I don't have any master. Can I tell you, you do? Oh, everybody's got a master. It may be a beer bottle. It may be drugs. It may be pills. It may be pleasure. It may be lust. It may be money. But you have a master. You have something that controls you, something that you obey. But I want my master to be the one that spoke the world into existence. And God said, and it was so. That's how He created it. I want my master to be the one that paints the rainbows in the sky. I want my master to be the one that came to earth and was born of a virgin. I want my master to be the one who lived a sinless, perfect life. I want my master to be the one who gave His life on the cross for me and was crucified, dying in my place, dying as my substitute. I want my master to be the one that was buried in the tomb and for 3 days and three nights was there. And then on the Sunday morning, up from the grave, He arose with a mighty triumph for His foes. That's my master. Just like He was Mary's master. He's my master. He's my Lord. He's my commander. He's my Savior. Master meant He was everything. My master means it's personal. It's personal. We tell the inmates all the time, sometimes we say it here, believing that Jesus is the Savior of the world will not get you to heaven. There are people in hell this morning that believe Jesus is the Savior of the world. In fact, the demons themselves believe Jesus is the Savior of the world. The way you get to heaven is you have to believe that Jesus Christ is my Savior. It has to become personal. You have to trust Him as your personal Savior. And He'll become your Savior. My Savior. And then let me give you statement number three this morning. Statement number three is the word master was used for Jesus only. Look at some scriptures with me, will you? You're in John 20. Look at John 13. John chapter 13. I'm glad I have a Bible this morning. John chapter 13. This is Jesus after He had girded Himself with the towel and washed the feet of the disciples. Verse 13, what does Jesus say to them? Ye call Me Master and Lord, and ye say, well, for so I am. You call Me Master, and you do it right, because that's what I am. The Lord kept that title for Himself. He's the Master. Look at Matthew 6 and verse number 24. Matthew 6 and verse 24, the Sermon on the Mount. Most of you are familiar with this. Jesus said, no man can serve two masters. You'll hate the one and love the other, despise, hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is a Bible word for money or the filthy lucre. Look at Matthew 23 and verse 10. Matthew 23 and verse 10, Jesus rebuking the Pharisees. And he says, woe unto you, in Matthew, 23 verse 10. He says, neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even who? Christ. He's the master. When Mary saw the master, when she saw him and she says, Rabboni, which is to say master, what she was saying was, I don't have any other master. Only Jesus Christ. Living for Jesus, a life that is true. Striving to please Him in all that I do. Yielding allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give my life to Thee. For Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I owe no other master. My heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for Thee alone. Master. You know something this morning, church? Listen to me. Jesus Christ would be just as happy this morning to hear you call Him Master as He was to hear Mary call Him Master. Do you know Him as your Savior? Can you say He's my Savior? Is He not just, I'm not just the Lord, is He your Lord? Not just the Master, but can you say He's my Master? Are you willing to recognize this morning you're a slave for Jesus Christ? And you will serve Him with your life. You'll do as He says, that He is your master. Now, you do not know Him. I believe you, before you can know Him as your master, you need to know Him as your Savior. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. If God sent a Savior, somebody needed to be saved. And that somebody was you and me. If you've never ever received Christ as your Savior, I pray you'll call upon Him today and ask Him to be your Savior. He died for you. He died for your sins. He died for my sins. And when I recognize the fact that one day Christ died for me and that I should deserve and I do deserve to die and go to hell for my sins. But Jesus took my place. And my friend, He didn't just take my place, He took your place. He was our substitute. God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He did on our behalf. Every sin that I'd ever committed and sins I hadn't committed yet, but He knows I will, He laid on Himself when He died on that cross. And He said, God, punish me instead of Stan Slabaugh. He said, God, punish me in place of Danny Wright. He said, God, punish me in place of Bob Wallace. Everything that we would have suffered and died and suffered in hell for our sin, Jesus suffered for us when He died on the cross. By the way, God accepted His payment. That's what this resurrection was all about, we read this morning. That was God raising His Son from the dead, saying, I'm accepting my Son's payment for the sin of mankind. And God said, that's what each of us must do. We must, by faith, accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. His payment for our sin is our hope for heaven. And He gives us the gift of eternal life, and we shall be saved. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. God says eternal life's a gift. And a gift, we understand, because when I get a gift, I realize I get a gift because someone else has already paid for it. When it's your birthday, it's Christmas, you open up a gift because you know someone who loves you and cares about you has gone out and done all the work and paid the price and wrapped it up and gave it to you. And you simply have to receive it and accept it. But boy, when it's funny, when you ask people how to get eternal life, they all start telling you what you have to do. Well, you better get baptized. Well, you better go to church. Well, you better keep the commandments. Well, you better do this. You better do that. Wait a minute. If I have to do all that, how come God says it was a gift? If eternal life is God's gift to us, and that means it's already been paid for, who paid for it? Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross. That's why the verse says, the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's not the eternal life through the Baptist church. Because the Baptist church didn't die for your sins. Baptist church didn't pay for, by the way, neither did the Catholic church. And neither did the Methodist church. And neither did any church. Jesus died for your sins. You by faith, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You call on Jesus and say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I should pay for my sin in hell. I believe you died on the cross and you paid those wages of sin for me. And Jesus, I will trust what you've done for me. And trust in the Bible simply means you put your weight on it. Just like you have your weight in your chair this morning. You have all your weight in that chair because you trust it. And salvation in the Bible is when you put all your weight on Jesus Christ and say, from this moment on, I'm trusting only what Jesus has done for me to give me the gift of eternal life and one day take me to heaven. God says when you call on Jesus and trust Him like that, you know what He says? You shall be saved. Did He say you might be saved? May be saved? Hope to be saved? No, you shall be. That's a guarantee in writing from God. If you put your faith and trust in Jesus alone, He gives you the gift of eternal life, and you shall be saved. Then you can tell people not just about the Savior, you can tell them that He's your Savior. Let me tell you about my Savior. And then as you realize He's your Savior and He's bought you with His blood and He's purchased you, you'll realize He's also your Master. And you'll want to live your life for Him. You realize I've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Now I belong to Him. Now I belong to Jesus. And Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. My Master. My Master. Know Him as your Savior. Bow your knee to Him as your Master. I pray you'll do that this morning. Father, take the truth now today. Thank you for everyone's attention this morning. Thank you, Lord, for these words uttered by Mary. My Master, Master. Lord, we owe no other Master. My heart shall be your throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Speak to hearts this morning, Lord, as only you can. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'm going to finish the prayer in just a moment. But right now, with our heads bowed, is just between you and God. I wonder how many folks in the room this morning would say, Pastor, there's a time in my life when I knew I was a sinner who needed a Savior, and I knew Jesus was the Savior I needed. And there's a time in my life when I received Christ as my personal Savior. And Pastor, this morning, He's not just a Savior to me, He's my Savior. And I'm trusting Him alone to get me to heaven one day. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip that up and say, Pastor, He's my Savior this morning? Is there people like that today? All right, you may put them down. Is there anyone here this morning who would say, Pastor, I don't know if He's my Savior or not. I don't know of a time in my life when I've trusted Him to be my Savior. Pastor, pray for me this morning. Would you slip your hand up this morning and say, Pastor, pray for me? Wonder how many believers here today would say, Pastor, he's my Savior, but I need him to be my master. He is the master. You make him my master. I realize I've been bought with a price. I realize my allegiance and my service and my commitment needs to be to Jesus Christ. That the focus of my life is not to be about the slave. The focus of my life is to be about the master. I wonder how many folks here this morning would say, Pastor, the Spirit of God stopped at my seat this morning. He spoke to my heart. I want the Lord Jesus to be my master. Pastor, pray for me this morning. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. You may put them down. That's good. Good decisions this morning. In a moment I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. You start with the master by bowing your knee to him. If you slipped your hand up this morning, in a moment when I pray, when I'm finished praying, we'll stand to our feet. The pianist will begin to play. Bob will sing our invitation hymn. When soon as you hear the first note from the piano, slip from your seat, come down to the front. Bow the knee at the altar to God. Husbands and wives, you raise your hand together, you come together. Make him the master of your home. Make him the master of your lives. He's everything. He's all you need. He's personal. He's your master. Father, thank you for speaking to hearts this morning. I pray that each one will do what you're bidding them to do in their heart, and that your will be accomplished in this invitation this morning. Lord, I pray that each of us would leave this room in just a few minutes saying that you're not just a Savior, you're my Savior. You're not just a master or the master, you're my master. And I'm so grateful to be a slave for Jesus Christ. I'll serve him all of my life. Lord, may you help each one to respond now to what you've told them to do in their heart. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist plays, as she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart this morning. Respond to him, will you please?
Living,
that's right.
Living for Jesus,
amen.
A life that is true. Striving to please him in all that I do. Yielding allegiance, glad hearted and free. This is a pathway, a blessing for me. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I owe no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer his call, follow his leading, and give him my all.
O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I owe no other master, my My heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
Father, we thank you for this morning. Lord, I pray that that would be our prayer this morning. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. I owe no other master. My heart shall be thy throne. Lord, I pray you'll help us to live the truth now this morning that we've been reminded of. Thank you for being a wonderful master to serve, a wonderful master to belong to. We love you. We pray that we'll glorify you today. Lord, I pray for Brother Fred and his family today. I pray you'll strengthen them and give Brother Fred and his family a great amount of grace today. May the grace be sufficient to meet the need. Lord, may they know and experience the love of God and the love of God's people today in a special way. Lord, I pray they'll know the peace that passes all understanding, and it'll keep their hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Give us a good afternoon and bring us back for our meeting tonight. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Don't forget 5:45 for the special meeting, organizational meeting. And this is where we have to feed, 500 people or so. So we want to be prepared for that. And we have turkeys, the vegetables, the pies, the salad, all the stuff. And so we want to, if you're not here, we'll just volunteer you. It's all right. But if you want to protect your interests, you might want to be here. And but I will be telling you about some of the incentives about getting guests here, and you'll want to be in on that. Be some nice things, and we're looking forward for God doing some great, great things. We have the tent coming again this year, so we'll be ready to go for whatever the Lord brings us on that day. All right, don't forget, grab some flyers, just sign them out so we keep track of how many are going out. They're turned every 50, and the reservation cards are down there as well. All right, let's sing I'm So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God. Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.